Rajna to talk about that. And now I will request Dr. Sangeeta Desai to introduce the guest. So over to Dr. Sangeeta Desai. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Puthul Sati. A very warm welcome from the Research Center for Women's Studies, SNDT Women's University. Today we are in the third week of the month-long series on gender sensitization and capacity development program, organized by Research Center for Women's Studies in collaboration with UGC. Today's resource person is Rachna Mudraboina. She is a trans woman and an activist, but her activism is not limited to transgender people's rights and queer movements. Besides working on these issues, she is also actively engages with people's movements of other marginalized communities, such as Dalits, workers, dairy farmers, and so on. Rachna's activism comes from a deeper understanding and conviction that transgender people do not come with their gender identity alone and have other marginalized identities of caste, religion, region too. Her work over the years has been geared towards forging solidarity among these different voices from the margins to strengthen each other's struggle. She uses social media platform very actively for expressing her thoughts, opinions, as well as build networks and strengthen her community-based activism. Rachna recognized that media lacked the sensitivity and basic understanding of the transgender community, thus propagating transphobia, discrimination, and negativity. To overcome this, Rachna has started the Transvision, a YouTube channel. The primary aim of this channel is to use it as a platform to dispel myths surrounding the community and to bring in a better understanding of the transgender community, create a safe social space within society, and initiate a dialogue on their issues. Welcome, Rachna. A request to all participants to mute the audio video during the lecture. The lecture will be for 40 minutes, followed by 10 minutes for the question and answers. Welcome, Rachna.
Thank you. Such a warm and such a wonderful welcome. Thank you, Putulji, and thank you, Sangeeta ji. And only one issue I want to raise is that my preferred pronoun is she and her, not he, because I identify myself as a trans woman. And there is also a lot of, gender diversity within the transgender community, how they identify. For example, there are trans women, transgender women, trans men, transgender men, intersex people, and also hijra, kinnar, and all these various religious identities or cultural identities, which itself become an umbrella, like a trans umbrella, where you find different diversity of genders between the binary, the male and female. So, sabhi saathiyon ko satrangi salam, and my today's conversation will be mostly in bi-language, like bilingual. It can be in Hindi and English. Is that okay for everyone? I feel hope so.
Yes, yes. Rachna, yes, please, yes.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for the confirmation. So before I start my lecture, I want to narrate one incident. There are many incidents during the COVID, but one incident I want to narrate, which is very new incident and which is a very heart-touching incident. 1 week back, one of my trans daughters, I usually make a trans daughters because I'm a trans woman, and there is also other relationship within Hijra community, the Guru Chela, but I'm not into the Hijra community. So I follow mother and daughter relationship within the transgender women community. So one of my trans daughters has call me and tell me that she is regularly getting fever, and she also caught up with cough and also inconvenience in breathing. Then I thought of that I should rush her to the hospital, but she has already been to couple of hospitals where she has gotten testing, and few testing reports are not shared with her. She has been sent and she has been asked to visit other testing centers and asked to visit the government testing centers also, and with very fear and scared, and she's very in trauma conditions. And she called me and said that that I want to come to home and I want to stay with you. I'm feeling alone and I'm really very scared. Then I asked her to come to my home. Then soon she came to my home. Then I asked other people to vacate one room and keep her in that room and take care of her. Soon I called my friends, my women activist friends, and also who are rigorously working in the COVID relief activities. Then they told us to take her to the government hospital, government testing center, and with very lot of counseling of her, because she's scared to visit actually the hospital because she has a fear of getting into a quarantine center alone. But after one day counseling, regular counseling, we were able to take her to the hospital. And from the gate of the hospital, government hospital, she has taken inside. Of course, she has been left with a mobile to communicate with me every single minute. So when she has been into this quarantine center, she has been so scared. She has been so feared. She has been so disturbed and went again to the trauma condition. And she has been repeatedly calling me saying that I cannot stay here. There are men and women around and I feel so uncomfort. Then I asked her, okay, I'll talk to doctor and ask her to shift to the separate, care or separate room so that you won't feel inconvenience among the men and the women. Then she has not been actually attended by the doctor, but she has given medicines and food, but she has not shifted to a separate room at all. And today is the last day. It's 1 week plus 1-2 more days. And she has discharged today from the quarantine center after staying and after she has been treated and she got the negative report. So you all should understand why transgender people felt so trauma, felt so feared, felt so scared to stay within men and women. Because it is so, the society has been treated us from our childhood. We have been disowned by our own families, disowned by our own mother, father, sister, brothers, uncles. And after that coming outside, we are disowned by the schools. The school doesn't want children who are gender non-conforming. And that's how we left with no education. And that's how we ended on the roads, either by begging or doing sex work in the dark night. So we are accustomed, we are supposed to, and we are forced to live with our own community. We made our own community. There are a lot of people from various religions, caste, class, leave everything behind from their childhood, run out of their houses, live together. And that is called the Hijra community and the transgender community. The Hijra community, transgender community is the women community. I know a lot of people who are now watching me or listening to me are most of them women and belongs to the women's studies. And they can understand the pain of the women who has been disowned by own families and who has been continuously disowned.
Vatsala, some problem?
No, I can hear you, but I can't hear her. Rachna, we can't hear her. So maybe something with her. I guess she...
पावर चले गया था. ठीक है, कोई बात नहीं. हाँ, तो मैं बोलना चाह रही थी कि आज वो मेरा बेटी घर आ गई है, लेकिन बहुत डिस्टर्ब हुई है कि वो इस सफर से गुजरना पड़ा, उसको इतना भयानक सफर से गुजरना पड़ा. वो बहुत डिस्टर्ब हुई उनकी कम्युनिटी की लोगों के साथ, उसकी माँ के साथ, उन्हीं बहनों के साथ वो नहीं रह पाई क्वारंटीन सेंटर में जो है. तो बाकी लोगों के साथ बहुत ट्रॉमा फील करी वो. तो मैं वही बोलना चाह रही कि ये दर्द को शायद आप सभी लोग अंडरस्टैंड एहसास कर पाएंगे
कि ये कैसा एक एहसास रहेगा कि अपना ही लोगों से हम जब डिजोन हो जाएंगे तो इतना दुख भरी वो संगठना होगा। तो अभी
असली रचना, I just interrupt you, your video has gone.
Yeah, now it's okay. Is that okay? तो अभी मैं असली मुद्दे पे, मतलब जो इश्यू मेरे को दिया गया कि कोविड के दौरान, ड्यूरिंग द कोविड पीरियड, what is the position of the transgender community actually? So I want to bring some facts in front of you all, and which the intellectuals and the university spaces should know actually, regarding what have been the struggle of the transgender community during the COVID. Soon the lockdown has been declared. It was so unplanned. We all are disturbed and we all are shocked. And yes, you all shocked. The transgender community was also in great shock. And the shock is and of the same, because we have nothing planned in our hands. But you have to know that transgender community have been sustained on begging and sex work from years and ages. So their daily routine is based that they have to go for begging daily, they have to get the alms, or they have to go for sex work, they have to earn the money. And the next day again, they have to go because there is no savings, there are no other works for them to live on. And that's how they live daily, working on a daily basis. Because of lockdown, they are forced to live in the house. They cannot go outside. And they, whatever the little money they have saved, have gone for the, you know, essentials like buying the groceries, rice, pulses, and everything. And many of them have other needs also. So transgender persons have a special needs. For example, a transgender person who is undergoing transition, who want to go a surgery from male to female or a female to male, they have to take the hormones continuously, either male hormones or female hormones. They cannot stop those hormones till their transition and means surgery. And after the surgery also, they are supposed to do that. Few people, so that is not available for them because they don't have money in their hands to purchase the hormones. Few people who have planned their surgeries have been stopped because of the lockdown. Apart from that, many of them have no subsidized food cards like ration cards, BPL cards, which all the states used to provide for the marginalized communities which are below poverty line. And because of that, they don't have any such social entitlements or food cards. They are not able to link with the schemes which the government has declared for the civil supply systems, for the groceries, for the medicines, or any such cash benefits. And as you all know, we have only one census available in our country, that is of 2011. According to that, our country has 5 lakhs transgender people. That is the census of 2011. But till now, we have no fresh census with us for the transgender community. I think that will be more scientific and that will be more unscientific to assess that, like, for example, the University of California said that in some study, randomly for every 1,000 people in a given town, 10 such people will be transgender people. Based on that snowball effect calculations, we can say that randomly 2.5 crores or at least 25 lakhs of transgender people will be there in our country. And where is 2011 census showing that 2.5 lakhs, and where is 220 if you estimate on based on this study that can be randomly depend on our population, it can be go up to 25 lakhs. So soon the lockdown has been declared. We all transgender activists of this country have written to the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, because that's the department which has been dealing with the transgender issues from 2016. They have been assigned to draft a bill called Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Bill 2016, which now has become an act 2019. It has become an act. So I'll describe about how all the struggles regarding this 2016 bill and act, and also in the shade of 2014 Supreme Court Nalsa versus Union of India judgment. So after we have written to the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment, the ministry told that we can give a kit amount of 1500 rupees to each transgender person, which can be transferred directly to the bank accounts of transgender people. But we said hardly many of the transgender community doesn't bear any bank accounts because they doesn't have any social entitlements like voter ID card or Aadhaar card or any such BPL subsidized food card or the PAN card to get a bank account. Then they came out with another solution for that. They said that, okay, we will now provide a direct money distribution system to district magistrate. And like that, like they have provided for up to 4,000 people, transgender people, they have transferred the money to their accounts, 1,500 rupees as a COVID-19 special kit. And another 1,000 people have been distributed this money through district magistrates. But that's come to only 1% of the population according to the 2011 5 lakh census, census of transgender people. There are 99% other, community transgender people which were not covered under this scheme. Then we have rewritten to the government to extend this scheme to the other 99% of transgender community also, and also to enhance the amount from 1,500 to 3,000 because it's already 2 months the lockdown and people are not able to go out and they are badly needing of money. And people need money because transgender people need money because I said as many of them have been have to force to pay the rents, have to force to purchase the medicines for their like special medicines like hormones and also and there is specific needs for transgender people other than the small needs like to purchase the gas, to purchase the milk or edible vegetables or also sort of things. And the government may, and we have seen that like across the states, many of the state governments except Kerala and somewhere near around like in West Bengal and Manipur, no other governments have come out with a specific policies for transgender people. Kerala is the first state which came with a policy saying that 2,000 rupees pension, special pension should be provided to the transgender people under the Kutumbashree program, the community network. And the quarantine centers are open to the transgender people in Kerala. And in Manipur and West Bengal, these two are specific transgender quarantine centers have been opened. Other than that, across the states, we have not found any such singular government which has passed an order or a notification for the benefit of the transgender people during the COVID-19 lockdown. So we approached the high courts. We have filed two litigations in Bihar High Court, two public interest litigations in Bihar High Court, and one in Chhattisgarh, one in Jharkhand, one in Madhya Pradesh, and one in Maharashtra. And all the courts have reacted positively, saying that the transgender community should be provided with the ration without asking for any social entitlements like ration cards, voter cards or Aadhaar cards. And they should be given not only the fruit groceries, but also medicines, fruits, and also the vitamin supplements to them. Luckily, in Telangana, the state in which from which I comes like we have a network called Telangana Women and Transgender Joint Action Committee, which is very active in lobbying with the government and do a lot of public interest litigations here. So through this network, we have been approached the Telangana government, and Telangana government said that they will be providing this ration. Other than this, many of the civil society organizations are turned on and provided a lot of help to the transgender community. Approximately in Telangana itself, we are able to mobilize 40 lakhs rupees worth of food groceries and also cash to the transgender communities through our network called Telangana Women and Transgender Joint Action Committee. I'm really proud to say this because other than any other networks, the women network has been in forefront. The women activists has been forefront. The women-led NGOs have been in forefront in helping the transgender community. Because women movement has extended their hands and hugged us from long years because our struggles has been similar from the beginning. Women have been kept very reserved. They have been treated as a secondary gender and they have been confined to the kitchens only at one point of time in past generations. But that's where the struggle has begun. And now women have equally fighting with the men to claim their own spaces in every way, in every single space. And that's how we have been. And they have been in solidarity with us and we have been in hand in hand, walking with the women's movement across this country to acquire the transgender rights. So I can say that women movement has been the pioneer, and we are following the footsteps of the women movement, and the transgender community movement, trans movements of this country, is nation, is the subsidiary, and is a product of this women rights movement. And women rights movements always has sensitized us and have been taken along with them hand in hand. Apart from that, the needs for groceries and needs for medicines have been supplied by the various civil society organizations. There was also another need which has been unaddressed during the COVID-19 lockdown. That is the psychological counseling. You all might have known there have been a lot of helplines which has been opened for the cis community, means other than LGBT communities, to counsel the people to come out of the trauma they have been facing during the lockdown. Except one such helpline, which is initiated by Libya in Mumbai. I think those are the people who actually volunteered to do social cycle counseling online for the LGBTQ people. Other than that, we have not seen a single such counseling center online, which came forefront and said that we will be dealing with the socio-psychological issues of the transgender people. We have seen few suicides, for example, in Goa, one transgender woman, because of the poverty she faced during the COVID, she had committed a suicide. In Warangal, the Telangana, one of the districts, one transgender woman has been stabbed to death by a car driver. And in another incident, another transgender woman in Mumbai has been hanged herself to the suicide. So these are the few incidences where the suicidal attempts of a transgender community or psychosocial needs of the transgender community, the trauma of the transgender community during the lockdown has not been addressed. And this has been the major issues which has gone unaddressed actually. Apart from that, I want to share also the experience of transgender community during this distribution of groceries. Many of our transgender community, the Hijra community people, during our distribution process have approached and they expressed their fear for the COVID-19, because one fear is that if we have been caught up or been show up with the symptoms of COVID, will anyone test us or not? The first challenge is testing for COVID. Where we have to go for and who will do a free testing for us COVID? The second thing is, if we have been tested positive, who will take care of us? Are there separate quarantine centers or relief centers? Or we have to, if we have to go for a private thing, who will pay that much amount of money for? Because we have seen the doctors, lawyers, and all these people spend lakhs worth of rupees to get tested and to get the medical support for the being COVID-19 positive. So the second thing is whether we will be accepted in the quarantine centers and we will be given a preference to be separately treated in the in the quarantine centers. Third thing is, like, after getting out of this COVID-19 quarantine, the stigma follows. There are two types of stigma. Being a transgender person itself is a stigma, and now you have been infected by COVID-19. So will the transgender community accept you? Within the transgender community will accept you, because the transgender people live in a commune, under one shelter, sharing the common resources. Will that community again will invite you to live with them in the same space? That is one task. The other task is, if it has been known that some a particular transgender person has been infected by COVID, will society allow them to live in a single space along with their community and will let them to go out for the begging or the sex work? Many of the transgender community have expressed during the lockdown period that they feel that because COVID get infected through touch, many of them feel that the sex work is now ended actually. So one way of profession or livelihood for them has been ended closely, because there are ample of chances to, if they do the sex work, they easily get infected with the COVID, because COVID affect through by touch. So many of them expressed that now one of our livelihood options we lost, what will be our future? So the fourth and most important thing is, the first one is testing, the second one is COVID relief thing, COVID relief and COVID quarantine thing. The third thing is the stigma to be dealt with. And the fourth thing is that if we lost the livelihood options during the COVID or due to the COVID, then what will be other options left us with us? So then we have to do a brainstorming with them. And very luckily, we got a few group of transgender women in back in Telangana who have came with a new ideas, new innovative ideas. One group, such groups is Trans Equality Society, which came forward to do pickles and to do ginger garlic paste in a very hygienic way. And this is the group same which has been brought the license or bought the permission for the COVID relief activities. And they have approximately traveled 3,000 kilometers across, 3 to 4,000 kilometers across Hyderabad and Secunderabad Twin Cities, and have served approximately 2,000 transgender community, the COVID relief activities like distribution of groceries, medicines, kits or masks and sanitizers, everything. So such group have came forward. And there is also one funding agency from abroad, which is run by Anjali Rimi. She's our friend and good ally of us, who has been both supportive from US. And she runs a Parivar Bay Collective in California. So she provided a lot of economic help for us to get back the economic resilience of the transgender community who lost their livelihood options, which are mostly, who are mostly into the sex work or begging. So these are the reasons, these are the issues in front of us, like whether, how in future the transgender community will able to navigate through these problems, and along with COVID, how they will live again a new life and a new beginning actually. Because there are a lot of policy challenges, policy level challenges and legal level challenges. Now, when the issue of legal thing comes into a scene, I want to describe about what is the situation of actually transgender people's rights in this country. In 2014, you all know that Supreme Court of India, in its Nalsa versus Union of India judgment, have declared that the transgender community of this country have been. Have been kept away from their constitutional rights. Their constitutional rights have been violated from ages and ages. They have been kept away from their traditional education system and employment system. And that's how they have been pushed into the fringes of the society. And the Supreme Court also told that how does transgender people should identify, get identify themselves. Supreme Court told that other than transgender person, no other person has a right to identify themselves, himself, herself as a transgender person. Which means transgender person has own independence and own right to declare whether he or she is a trans person or not. And also the Supreme Court said that nobody should force a transgender person to get surgery to get identified as a trans person, which means if a trans person, either she or he get done surgery or not, should be identified as a transgender person based on self-identity. So this is the self-identity principle which the Supreme Court decision has been institutionalized. The second thing is, like, a transgender person can be identified as a male, female or trans person. And the trans person can be any identified themselves as a trans woman, trans man, or Hijra, Kinnar, Aravani, all these cultural identities, Shiva, Shiva Shakti, Jogni, Jogappa, everything. Any of the thing. So basically, it's none other than the transgender person who can identify themselves as a trans person. They have their own right to get identified. And also Supreme Court told that the transgender community should be identified as socially backward class. And they should be provide such benefits of socially backward class in education and also employment. This is because our society has been structured in many layers. We have class, we have religion, we have caste, and we have been systemized like that. And we institutionalized all those things in our systems itself. So being a trans person who has been disowned by the natal family, who has disowned by the social fabric, and have not been, and the transgender community doesn't have any such solidarity or, you know, collective social support to get through these systems, they need the reservation to acquire the minimum basic education and through that to acquire a minimum basic employment. Without that, the transgender community will be confined only to the begging or the sex work. That is very clear. And that has been told in the Supreme Court judgment. And that so they should be declared as a socially backward community. Apart from that, the Supreme Court also said that the welfare schemes like the food cards, the housing facilities, and also the pension schemes, all these schemes should be made inclusive. Transgender people should be included in those welfare schemes. And without that inclusion, they cannot be able to bring equality and independence to the transgender community. They will be thrown out into the roads, and they will be disowned by the society. That's how Supreme Court felt during this decision. But what have done from 2014 to 2020 is that the governments have not volunteered to implement this NALSA judgment. Rather, they disowned this judgment, and that we can see in 2016, the Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Bill came into existence. Now this bill have gone on the face of 2014 NALSA versus Union of Judgment in multiple ways. For example, the definition of a transgender person in this bill has been defined as a person who are born with the both organs or none of the organs or one organ developed or one organ underdeveloped, which is a variation called intersex variation. Actually, there is from the beginning, there is a confusion and conflation of sex to gender. Sex is different, gender is different. But again, in 2016, in the bill, they have introduced that the definition of the transgender person similar to a definition of intersex person, which is very weird and which can make all the transgender 80 to 90% of the transgender keep away of this whole bill, and only the intersex people can be considered as transgender people according to this bill. And starting from that, in 2016, the bill also criminalized begging. They said that whoever person, transgender person, begs or make others, the enticement of begging also to beg, will be criminalized or put in prison for 2 years and for a penalty of 25,000 rupees. And this bill doesn't talk about any reservations or in the education or the employment. So this bill, I think in 2016, we have done a big movement around this bill, saying that this bill actually violates a lot of things, the constitutional rights of the transgender people, because this goes against the NALSA judgment the Supreme Court has delivered in 2014. And a lot of constitutional rights, right to freedom, right to life, and right to health, right to food, and right to housing, all these rights have been violated in this bill. Then after a few changes and a lot of changes in 2019 again, and the old bill, after like few changes, has been accepted with both the houses of the parliament, have made as a law. Now this law cannot be a constitutional, because it again institutionalized that if a person want to identify, transgender person want to identify as a male or female, such person has to get a certificate from the surgeon that he or she has undergone the surgery, which is unconstitutional according to the Supreme Court verdict. So this whole act itself has been unconstitutional. So we challenged this. We group of activists again challenged this in the Supreme Court. And the hearing is pending and the notice has been served to the government. But still government is so adamant that during the lockdown period, COVID lockdown period, they have come out with rules. So now they said that within 10 days, you have to give us the suggestions on these rules and they keep it on their website. And we said that 10 days during lockdown, we cannot move, we cannot travel. How can we do consultations itself? Like, you know, then we said that you have to extend the time. Then they extended another, I think 15 days more. And we have done the online discussions and also consultations to get suggestions of the community. And we have given the suggestions. And recently last month, the second time they have come out with the rules. And they said that this time you have to in person have to submit these rules to the ministry. Okay. Again, we have done a lot of consultations online and we have submitted our suggestions. But what I feel is that the basic act itself is being unconstitutional. And these rules also have been very different. Like, for example, let me say that one of the rules say that the transgender person who have got their identity as male, female or transgender person before the commencement of the rules are not supposed to change their old identity, can follow their old identity. Which means the people who are going to get a new identity according to these rules, wanted to get an identity, will get only a transgender identity. But if they want to get a male or female identity, they again need to go to get a doctor's surgeon. A surgeon certificate to certify that so-and-so person has get done surgery done to be declared as a trans woman or trans man. So the people who already prior to commencement of the rules have this convenience of without any doctor certificate that male and female they can carry on. But after the commencement of this rules again, we are asking for doctor certificate, which felt very different, you know. And there is one chapter itself in the law saying that transgender community, the transgender person who is bonded and supposed to be in a bonded labor situation should be rescued and to be rehabilitated. Now we need to understand this logic behind this rescue and rehabilitation and the bonded labor thing. Because if you consider a certain culture is in under a bonded labor system, what is bonded labor system? Actually, saying transgender community, the trans people are under bonded labor system, we need to understand the culture actually. So there is a hijra culture in our country and there is a cultural identity, and it got a cultural identity and it got a cultural pride, and also it got a cultural importance also in South Asian region across. So there is guru, there is chela. So guru is the master and chela is the disciple, and because they are disowned by their natal families, they live together. They come one place and they live under one shelter, and they go, they beg alms, and they come and they share the common resources. If they felt ill, if someone has died, someone has lost their hand, someone is very old, they look after themselves. The natal families doesn't come, or either anyone from the society doesn't turn up and attend their needs. Actually, the transgender community have to be self-dependent and have to serve their own community. So in that way, this community has been sustained all these years. But now if you say that in certain community, the bonded labor system exists, then it is a risk on the mere nature and mere basic, base of the community itself, basic structure of the community itself. You say that if there is bonded labor, then you are supposed to say that transgender people are in bonded labor system in the Hijra system. Let them rescue, they are in the bonded labor system, and then let them rehabilitate. Now, if any of the chelas go for begging, if any police caught them and say that you are under bonded labor system, now you need to be rescued and you need to be rehabilitated. And that's how they start rehabilitating every single transgender person on the road if they go off for begging or the sex work. then we will see at the end of the day that all the transgender people ended in the rehabilitation homes. So what is the spirit and what is the object behind this whole chapter of rehabilitation and rescue and rehabilitation actually? And these rules also talk saying that a specific transgender cell will be provided in each every single police station. Why do transgender people only need a specific transgender cell actually? I didn't get that. So instead of giving the rights, instead of protecting the rights, instead of treating them as humans, we have been again and again suspected. Our identity has been again and again suspected. People want to see our bodies, make us nude and examine our organs and want to certify that whether we are transgender or not. And this is very inhuman, I feel that. This is the ugliest part of the gender discrimination which any human can face on the earth, I feel like. If men and women can walk out in any dress saying that I'm a man and women, why not transgender person cannot be self-identified? Why do they need screening? Why do they should denuded in front of any person or get a doctor's certificate to prove that I'm a trans person? This is the basic challenge which actually we are asking. And this narration has to be changed. And many times the government said that if this thing is not there, the screening is not there, many women and men may enter into transgender community and they may claim that we are transgender people, which is not easy, I feel. The day I went out of my house, the day, every day I cross my threshold, I'm faced to a lot of discrimination, a lot of transphobia. People take names, Chakka, Mamu, Hijda, Good, all these names. And people deny facilities, people deny services. People never allow us to enter into the malls. People never allow us to enter into the parks. And people are so skeptic to enter even temples and shrines also for us. So who and which man or a woman will able to take the identity, such identity, which has been criminalized, I can say, like, which has been not stigmatized, has been criminalized all these years, and which men or women will wanted to be a trans person? So that gender identity and claim. Apart from this, do the transgender persons protection of act rules or the act itself speaks any benefits for the transgender person? No, because there is no provision of reservation. Though the Supreme Court of India in 2014 said that many of the transgender communities, transgender people have been pushed into the fringes of society because they are not being part of the education system, not being the part of the employment system, they should be considered as a socially backward class. Now UGC, after 2014 judgment, UGC has sent circulars to all the universities and all the education institutions in this country across and asked to prepare committees, asked to prepare the guidelines, asked to provide a third column, so that transgender people may apply for the education, write the written test, write the entrance test, get entrance, get enter into the education institutions and universities, get read and get study and get qualified and get the jobs. But that's not the situation, because in 2015 itself and 14 itself, Grace Bano, a Dalit transgender rights activist from Tamil Nadu, has challenged in the Tamil Nadu High Court, saying that she has not been given the scholarship to enter as a student into the engineering college. Based on NALSA, she has been given reservation, and that's how she finished her BTech. And she's the first such person, transgender rights person, who have challenged the whole society for being discriminated to enter into the educational institution, being a Dalit trans woman and also being a trans person. And it's so important victory for all our transgender community. And following her, her daughter Tarika Banu has also filed a public interest litigation based on those lines, that she has been denied to entry into a medical college, and she has been also granted admission into a medical college. In the similar way, Preetika Yashini, the first SI in Tamil Nadu, transgender SI, has been also granted her job. So you can understand that the transgender rights have not been served voluntarily, because the state or the society never felt that these people, our people, need those rights or those equality or that independence. They have been always forced to visit the courts, get the judgments, and get them implemented by the states, which is very pathetic. Why this intention towards transgender community in the society? It's very simple. The patriarchy which existed in the society, the hierarchy which the patriarchy brings on. That's what we say, that when courts declared that now onwards you will be called as a third gender. Oh, come on, then we said, who is the first gender and the second gender? So this is the hierarchy which patriarchy has created all these years. So you are making us to believe that man is the first gender, women are the second gender, and then follows the other genders. This is very pathetic. There should not be any hierarchy in any of the genders or any of the sexual orientations. That's what I feel like. So the women movement have continuously led long battles, a battle against domestic violence, a battle against sexual harassment at workplace, a battle against the rape laws, and battle against the marriage rights, property rights, and divorce rights. So this is how we connect with the women movement mostly, and the gender equality process, gender equality judgment or justice, and the gender human rights actually, which we follow, or we are with the women movement all this time, and they're more supportive to us to fight these battles. So during the COVID, as I said, and it's also now has been very difficult in order to build up the social resilience. Social resilience in the sense that, I'll narrate one example here. When the initial stages of COVID-19, the lockdown has not yet declared, but the COVID-19 has just entered into India. There were some posters around in Hyderabad we have seen on the pillars of the metro stations that don't entertain transgender people. You will get infected with COVID. If you see any transgender people across, call 100. So that type of transphobia has been propagated on transgender community even during COVID-19. So there is already some transphobia, and now again you are putting some myths and misconceptions into the thoughts of the society, saying that COVID will be infected through transgender people, which will add more trouble and more crime or violence to be happened to the transgender people. And we have seen also a lot of crime has happened during COVID-19 because even police are not able to attend any of the cases during COVID-19. Everything has been stagnant all over. We cannot go to the police station. We cannot call cops. We cannot visit. We cannot file a complaint, and we cannot get registered FIR. So that is the situation where crime has been. And people are in more poverty. The people who are more poorer face more crime and more violence from the society. And that's how transgender people, many of the transgender people have complained. There are two types of violence actually happen. One type. People who have partners, they face the domestic violence, and people transgender people who have partners, they face the domestic violence, and transgender people who are in the houses, they are gundas, and those people entering into the forcefully into the houses, beating them, taking them the money and everything from them. And the third type of thing is the violence from the owners, the landlords. The landlords ask many of the people to leave or to vacate the houses in the middle of the night, saying that because of you people, COVID can be infected. There are a lot of chances. So these are the very scariest things which I feel the transgender community has faced. And the most scariest things among this is like to the most curious thing they face is that disowned by the basic essentials to be supported by the state, and there is no policy for such, because patient cards or the basic food supplements card or basic entitlements like Aadhaar card or voter ID card. How can they sustain, or how can they get the COVID related relief and everything? So the last but not the least, which I want to say is that many of the transgender people want to shift to the other livelihood options, which now we are also designing a lot of projects around. People want to open beauty parlors, people want to work with sewing machines. We have supplied to 13 sewing machines to such transgender persons across 2 Telugu states. And we have one YouTube channel, Transvision YouTube channel, in which we are working on transgender issues. Many of the transgender issues has been shown in on our channel. And because a lot of myths and misconceptions are there regarding transgender people in the society, and to address that, we have started this channel. And other objective of this channel is to provide other livelihood options. We have all our staff, we are all our working crew, transgender people in Transvision. So there is no other single community. It's all made by the transgender people itself, which is very different actually. So this is one way of other livelihood options. And we, other than this, we are also crowdsourcing for people who want to start a mobile beauty parlor, a mobile barbecue center, or a vegetable shop mobile, or a cloth store. So people have approached us for funding, and we are also supporting them for crowdsourcing. So this is how we are supporting for the economic resilience of transgender people during COVID. Thank you, and I'm now open to the questions you can ask.
Thank you, Rachna, for highlighting so many issues that the transgender community is facing or has faced during the lockdown. The discrimination, the trauma, the lack of psychological counseling helplines, lack of relief measures, bearing a few by the state governments. But the livelihood has got impacted. And thank you also for highlighting the different identities that come under the term transgender community, and also for bringing the finer points on the Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Act, where yes, reservation is required to really bring them out of that infringement which is happening right now from their constitutional rights. We have a lot many questions, Rachna. First one that I would like to ask is, do you think that there is a regional divide in terms of transgender community activism, transgender movement and activism on the regional basis? What I mean is that, is it that the southern states are more proactive as compared to the rest of the country?
Of course, politically it was like that from the beginning. And many of the political parties have owned the movement in the sense of like own the transgender people, few leaders, and led the movement on their own way also. In the other say, the transgender people also have been subverted into the and diverted to the from the main trans movement to the other political ambitions or politically highlighted parties or states, actually what I feel. So basically, whenever people say that do you affiliate yourself to any of the political parties, then I from the beginning I have rejected that idea. Because I feel that for me, it's not right, left or center. What I feel is more important. So as today you can see, I have been wearing a 7 colors of sari, and I have been greeting you all saying Satrangi Salam. So this is what I, for me, the diversity is actually. So no single political party or no single party leader or a political party have talked about transgender rights from the beginning, And all our struggles during 377 also, it was like trans people who are in the forefront actually, for the 377 protest and the whole, historical movement behind 377, though it is more related to the, comes with the HIV background, or most of the funding from the HIV background. But it is the trans people who are in the front, right, from Dossier 377 also. And again, when comes the 2014 judgment also, it's the trans people who approach the Supreme Court, knock the door of the Supreme Court also. What I mean to say is that if few people have been subverted, or who will have been owned by few political parties, have been used by the political parties, show that they are in the forefront of the transgender movement, I feel that's not the real face of transgender community. There is definitely a division from south to north, I can say, and also northeast, because it's all politically, subverted or owned by the political parties, which I feel is not actually the true part of the trans movement itself. Because from being the part of the trans movement from the beginning, we have been taught and we have been teaching the people, and we have been propagating within the people also that we are not affiliated to any singular political party. But very truly, in the true spirit, we base our basic policies and ethics on the Ambedkarite philosophy. Yes, because he is the one, Ambedkar is the one who have drafted our constitution and who have thought of the communities which has been marginalized, not only based on the caste, class, religion, but also we feel we can also draw the inspiration of how gender marginalized people have been, treated based on the similar marginalities which has been faced by the people who have been into different caste, class, or religions. So I want to say, because these movements, the Ambedkar political movements, have been more strong in the southern state or some of the northeast states, and also few regional movements have been so strong in few states, they have given that independent, the trans activists on those areas have been more independent to work and only to speak about the trans rights. Now, let me clear this confusion, saying that a lot of times when we talk about transgender rights, these politically owned transgender activists many times argue saying that you are anti-government, anti-Modi, anti-BJP, all these things. And then I said, I have never talked those things in any of the platforms, actually. We have been talking about the transgender people's rights. That's it. It's a very clear-cut definition. It's a very clear-cut objective. And it's a very clear-cut thing which we want to express ourselves. So our fight has been, if transgender person has been given a right, we have to think about mostly marginalized transgender person of this country. A person who is on the roads for the begging, who is person in the darknet doing a sex work, who is forced to do all those things because the state has been not considered our rights in a true spirit. So there comes the division. Few activists are in a very fast run to say that whatever rights we get, whatever the state gives, we will take it. And that doesn't work in that way, I feel like. Even the women movement also, many times, for example, domestic, the Sexual Harassment Act is there. I think you all know, being like women's studies and gender studies, there has been a prolonged history for the Sexual Harassment Act. Women have been kept as subsidiary person in the working environment. They have been sexually violated, harassed, raped, molested, and even though they have been kept silent, and they have worked as a movement, as a women movement, they have worked as a policy for this, as a for the sexual harassment in the working place. And the women movement said that, doesn't jump it on and said that we need a law. They said that we will try this as a policy first in every single space, actually. Though we all can see that now this act has been also very much, watershed by the state. That is another aspect. But the women movement has said that we will be testing this in every single space of where women works, actually. And after that, only if we are confident, we ask the government to pass it as a law. So what I mean to say is that few people have been always, it's not only with trans movement, it's with every marginalized movement, will be owned by the political parties, will be used for their own motives, and will be used again as the movement also. And we think very less for them, because our main motto is the transgender rights in a true spirits. a transgender person should get their constitutional rights. What constitution has said, what Ambedkar has said to us, that has to be get implemented.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Our next question is from Anita. She wants to know, can you please throw light if you have connections with similar internationally based transgender community in order to have further vision, support to form your identity in the country you're living, or alternatively, where do you have, or from where do you take strength for the purpose from?
Oh, it's not a single collective, I feel, because I'm also part of, I'm part of a Human Rights Law Network. I'm working for the LGBT issues in the Human Rights Law Network. And that's how I've been get introduced in 2016 to the International Civil Liberties Organizations, INCLO. So I have been attended two such international conferences of trans INCLO, one in Cape Town in 2016 and another in 2019 in Argentina. So it's again a collective. And it's again the NGOs or the collectives from different countries who visit and at one place and discuss about the human rights progress and violation and report to one another and prepare a report and, you know, for distribute to the various human rights organizations across the country, across the world. So there are many of such collectives and organizations which you can get connected. And I'm also been, I've been also visited, visited to the UN, US embassy through, I have been visited the US during the Obama time. I have visited five states as a part of International Visitors Leadership Program in 2016. So these are the few experiences which I have been to various countries. But again, what I feel is that it's similar in every country. And I'm also part of now Parivar Bay Area Collective, which is run by Anjali Rimi. You can see my contacts and on Facebook and you can get linked to it. So these are the few international, networks and collectives which I have been connected with and working with from these years. And many of them are being supportive emotionally, ethically, and in true spirit of transgender rights. It's not every time that they do any financial support to me, but it's all the moral support which I drew from these sisterly and brotherly, you know, collectives, which talk and which really draw the lines of where we have been standing in terms of trans rights. So that's it. Thank you.
In your lecture, you mentioned about the discrimination and the trauma that the transgender community has faced during the COVID times. What Megha wants to know is if trans women and trans men face different problems because of the strong foundation of a patriarchal society that we live in.
Oh, what troubles they face, you mean to say?
No, is there any particularly distinction between the problems faced by trans women and trans men?
Of course. There are distinctions. For example, like give one single example. For trans men, for trans women, there is one single set of hijra communities which is very, you know, organized actually. So once the trans women or gender non-conforming child has left the families, there is another space where they can go actually, at least. They have some shelter, they give food and everything is available for them systematically, actually. So there is some organized community for your trans women actually. So and the emotional dependency also within the hijra community, it actually meets one another needs of emotional, you know, backup actually. And support system is also there emotionally. But when coming to the trans men, no such single organized community is available for trans men. So that makes trans men very emotionally backward when they disown by their natural families. This is only psychological conditions I'm talking about. And the physiological conditions are very different and very risky and vulnerable actually, I feel like. So once a trans man have left from the houses, they are forced to work in small hotels on the highways, dhabas. They have to cover their body. They have to wear 2-3 t-shirts to press their chest, to make the people believe that they are not girls in terms of their body. And if they have been known that they are girls in terms of their body, and men will like feel that they are available for everything. So they are vulnerable to rape, you know. And this is the rape which if trans men have been disowned by the families and run away from their house. There are many trans men who have been faced the corruptive rape within the, you know, domestic setup of the families itself. There are families, there are cases which we have attended actually, where the own mother or her father or the people say that now this lady, this woman has been behaving like a man, and she needs to be shown her place. Some relative they called and they said that rape her. This is called corrective rape, which is very brutal actually, and which leaves the trans person into lot of trauma the whole life remaining actually. So the psychological dependency and the psychological needs of trans women and trans men are different actually. And coming to the last but not the least, the transitional issues also. So the trans women, they want, who are transitioning from a male body to a female body, so they also need to use the hormones. And the hormones are very cheaply available, not that much cheaply, but they are available in the market regularly. And there are oral contraceptives and all those things which they, through the proper guidance of, you know, endocrinologists, they go and take. And also surgeries in the private hospitals are available for them. But for trans men, the hormones, they have to take the shots actually every week and every for 2 days or 3 days, which are very painful and which need the doctors and proper doctors to do that actually. Again, go into their trauma and that will upset them actually, you know. So these are the different things actually, and also the how the emotional needs of trans women and trans men are dealt with. Trans women, if they have a life partner, if they have a partner, so they are open to choose a partner. If though the marriages are not legal in this country. Trans women, we have seen many of the trans women get married and get into the open relationship. But with the trans men, it's very hard to get a partner and to sustain the relationship. And if there are any relationship basis troubles, they again go into the trauma again. And they need a lot of psychological pushback to keep up their transitioning, keep up their mental trauma during the breakup and all those things. So altogether, there are different issues, psychological issues of trans men and women. To be dealt.
Thank you. Dr. Puthul Sate has a question. Transgender community has been stigmatized and discriminated during the outbreak of HIV and again now during COVID pandemic. So how has the transgender movement responded to this situation?
It's very tough actually because till now, whoever the COVID-19 positive or patients we have seen within the transgender community, most of them, 80 to 90% of them are HIV positive. So this can be due to the irregular medicines they take for, like the ART antiretroviral they take for the HIV treatment. That can be one of the reasons, discrepancies in our irregular intervals in taking of HIV medicines, or a fear of like being a HIV positive person. That they are more prone to the COVID-19 also. So HIV itself was a trauma for us and it was a shock for us whoever have been infected, dealing with them and daily routine blood checkup for CD4 count and get them tested for the taking to the ART centers, getting the regular ART to them and also supplements for them, food supplements or vitamin supplements. This whole thing has been a very tedious task for the organizations also who are working on HIV prevention and care. And we don't have care and support, HIV care and support for transgender people specifically. We are not able to put a care and support, specific care and support centers for transgender people. We are not able to provide a specific targeted intervention for transgender people themselves. So there are a lot of things to be implemented even by the NACOLs, which have not been implemented for the transgender people, exclusively for the transgender people in the services, which I mean to say for HIV prevention or care and support. Now again, the COVID enters into the scene. So now there are a lot of discussions happening, whether the HIV funds may be diverted to the COVID, then who will be dealing with the HIV care and support, who will be providing the HIV RT medicines for transgender people, where they have to go, and how they will get medicines. If government is not going to supply in free of cost, whether they will be able to purchase them or not. And this is one burden already, we have been within the transgender community. And another burden is that if COVID is going to be worrying more the transgender community, then as I said previously also, how will be the testing for COVID, and how will be the quarantine center set up and relief, and how to deal with the stigma actually once the transgender person has been infected with COVID, obviously. So these are the few challenges which we are trying to, we have been talking continuously with the NAC also as a collectives, and also the funders, international funders also, to not to discontinue the HIV funding, to be continue that funding to the transgender community and also the marginalized MSM community. Apart from that, we also additionally demanding that not only ART or care and support, you have to give the supplement support also, like ration and all those things. The fund should be used for them also, because now the COVID also entered into the scene. Right? So these are the few things actually we are balancing with the HIV and also COVID-19.
What is, we have one question, what is the way ahead post-COVID times to bring trans people into the mainstream? So apart from the policy changes, apart from making an inclusive policy, is there any other measures that need to be taken?
There is no yet another, like a dialogue which has been initiated on inclusive policy, what I feel. Even the COVID entered into our life actually. So this transgender rules itself is a very big example for that there is no inclusiveness at all. Neither the exclusive trans, specific facilities are going to be provided. So there is a long battle to be fought, I feel. And leaving aside from the state that we are also now dependent mostly on the civil society, collectives, saying that in order to upheld the economic resilience of the transgender people, try to believe on the transgender people and try to invest on the transgender people who will show the success actually. So what I mean to say is that you need to believe on the people in order to get a system to be developed actually. So similar to the other communities also, transgender community need to be believed first. They should be provided with the finance. They should be open for the do other livelihood options or other businesses in the society. And that's how they can be hand in hand and shoulder to shoulder go with the claim the equality within all other spaces also. You should invest in some other liability options business, which now for civil society we are like actually. Many of the civil society organizations have been helping us actually in getting. Want to run a shop or want to run a boutique or beauty parlor, all those sort of things. Yeah.
This question is from Dr. Vatsala Shukla from RCWS itself. She says that SNDT, through its distance education department, has taken the initiative to enroll transgender people and to enhance their enrollment. However, in spite of this, we could not mobilize them for enrollment. So what do you think are the most pressing inhibitions or barriers?
Sorry, I didn't get the question. Come again.
SNDT has, through the distance learning program, had taken an initiative to enroll transgender people and to enhance their enrollment. And it also conducted a need-based survey on transgender people's educational needs in terms of specific courses. However, in spite of all this, the university could not mobilize them for enrollment. So what do you think would be the inhibitions?
So this problem is historical, traditional, I feel like. So in order to change a policy or bringing a policy to make transgender people more inclusive, you need to do a basic survey of who are people in need actually in this actually. This is how we work in the Telangana also. We have prepared a list of people who are in need actually, who got the basic education, you know, or who doesn't have any basic education, but who wanted to actually shift to the other livelihood options or wanted to do the education, proper education, other education systems, what I feel. So, hello, am I audible?
Yeah, we can hear you, Rajna.
Yes. We can hear you.
It has been hanged actually. So that's how like we have prepared a list of the people, list of the transgender people, all from Andhra and Telangana. And whenever there is a need, then we chip on in saying that there is a placement and there is a opening for further education. That's how we actually worked in actually. So and that is the one thing, basic thing we need to do after basic analysis or assessment within the community. The second thing is like we need to show some role models actually. If, for example, Preetika Yashini was one of such role models from a transgender community, that you can also do an inspector job, police inspector job in the community. And following Preetika Yashini, there are 10 plus transgender women now in the Tamil Nadu who are serving in the police department actually. So if you just make people to believe that you need to study and you need to complete your study, then you can also have a nice position employment after your study. That itself, the journey itself will be a role model to the other people saying that now some person has done this, I can also do this. Without these role models and without showing these results, even transgender community will be also very inhibitive to leave their profession. Actually, they have a ready profession which they have developed with from out of nothing actually, the beginning of the sex work. So in order to leave this, you have to show something actually, you know, to the transgender community to make them believe that now this journey is going to be very successful actually.
Sangeeta, there are a few more questions.
I'm going to combine these two questions now. One question is, the transgender community as a group, do they get benefit of the insurance policies, the health insurance policies? And second is also regarding health. Is the menstrual management, do you think, is one of the key issues? And how do you deal with it?
One is menstrual management, other one is?
Are there any insurance policies for health? Health-related policy?
No.
Okay.
So there are no single like health insurance policy which are in use, I think, helpful for the... for the transgender people, but the LIC has included the HIV, you know, infected persons to be considered for the LIC. That is one thing which actually we can consider. But other than that, I feel what I feel is like for the health issues, specific health needs like transition, sex reassignment surgery, and all those things. I think. I think there is no inclusive process. The Pradhan Mantri insurance policy scheme is there for 5 lakhs, but for that also the transgender persons need to be recorded in the data actually of the government. They must be found in the data of the government. So many of the people who are now at present living are not into the data of of the government. So how can they serve, like how can be they serve this actually the Pradhan Mantri insurance scheme, the 5 lakhs amount which they will get under this insurance scheme. So I feel like that there is no inclusiveness as a trans person in any health policy, either for the transition or for the life insurance or any other health needs, I feel.
And the second question was on menstrual management. How does one deal?
Actually, menstrual management, many of the transgender people, and including me also, have been part of these studies and also, programs of regarding sensitizing the menstrual cycle and also the gender, discrimination, which the girls, young and adolescent girls go through during this process, and all these have been part of and being a resource person for this whole series of menstrual studies and also sensitive programs, and apart from this few, I think in Maharashtra I have been part of NCCI, and there is a group of NCCI is the National Council of Church of India. I've been on the core team of this gender diversity forum, where we have been seen one group of trans women in Mumbai have been specifically engaged in making the pads, sanitary napkins actually. So they run these missions, they prepare them and supply to the government. So, and also I have one friend in Bihar, Reshma. She's also have been continuously doing the sensitization programs around the Bihar and Jharkhand regarding the menstrual, programs and cycles. So I feel that transgender people are the more convenient to be with the women and the women related issues, and that's how the gender diversity has been so open and so has been, and the women and has been extended their solidarity to the trans women because of this so diverse nature of itself. So that's how we have been made part of all these diverse relative issues, including the menstrual thing also. Yeah, thank you
so much Rachna for this session, and also for so patiently answering to so many questions that our participants had. Thanks a lot, and I may request now Dr. Puttul Sathe, our head of department, to convey vote of thanks.
Yeah, so on behalf of the center, Rachna, I really thank you for this, for a very thank powerful you. Session. Thank no, you thank you very much. And of course, I'm not, in fact, this is not the end for us. I will be inviting you to the center where we can have more detailed discussion, because I think there's still very little known about, you can say about the issues of inclusivity when it comes to transgender, and the manner in which even we use the term also transgender, frankly speaking, that is something that is which we need to be aware of. So on behalf of the center, I thank you, Rachna.